Coast to Coast AM, Part 2, Men in Black.
What's the link, Nick, between the Men in Black and Ouija boards?
This is probably one of the weirder aspects of the entire mystery, George. One of the people I interviewed for the book was an Anglican priest named Ray Beauché, who lives in Lincoln, Nebraska. And as well as being an Anglican priest, Ray's also a former state director for MUFON, the Mutual UFO Network. He used to run the Nebraska chapter of MUFON. And in other words, he's someone who has a background in the Christian church and also in ufology. And Ray has deeply dug into the UFO mystery and the Men in Black mystery, even to the point of he actually met once Albert Bender and was in touch with Ray Barker also for a number of years. And Ray has come to the conclusion that in his view, the Men in Black have literally like demonic origins. That's his firm conclusion. And one of the things he points out and notes is that a lot of the people who had involvement with the Men in Black or been visited or interacted with them have also been involved in the occult. For example, Albert Bender used Ouija boards. Claudia Cunningham, who I mentioned at the Albany Cemetery story, her friend Linda, who had the experience, she was a user of Ouija boards. And Mary Robinson, who saw this weird man in black outside her apartment in Jersey City that Tim Beckley photographed, she was a big fan of Ouija boards. And there are other cases where, as Ray points out, that people who've had visitations of the Men in Black, when the MIB experiences have occurred, either in the immediate wake or at this very time of the encounters, there have been outbreaks of poltergeist activity in the homes of the people. Now, of course, this sounds highly bizarre and controversial, but there's no doubt that it is an aspect of the phenomenon, you know, and that's why, you know, some people like Ray have gone down the path suggesting that it's far more occult-based than it is sort of flesh and blood and physical. Mm-hmm. My own take on it is I do think there's an aspect of this to it, but what I'm more inclined to believe is that this is sort of another aspect of the Men in Black mystery. You know, I don't think it can account for all the Men in Black stories. I think what it does demonstrate is that we have at least three or four strands of MIB, all sort of under the MIB banner, but some of them actually having wildly different origins. You know, we could actually be looking at government people, aliens, time travelers, and something paranormal that have, you know, the UFO community has had a tendency to put them all under one banner, when really, you know, we should be looking at them, each case on its own merits, and they may have wildly different origins.
Well, that's a good point. What have you found to be some of your strangest cases that you've come across?
Well, you know, I think everything about the Men in Black certainly smacks of high strangeness. I think more than anything else, you know, it's the sort of the collective ways and means by which the MIB appear and vanish. I think possibly, you know, the oddest thing of all, and I think this is a theory that has a lot of merit, is the theory of tulpas, which has been offered for the Men in Black. The tulpa, the idea is, you know, that human mind, if it focuses on one particular image, can kind of externalize that image and sort of give birth to like a mind monster. Some people speculated, you know, that's what the MIB are. You know, they're sort of the image of the black suited intimidating person is sort of deeply rooted in the human consciousness, and we actually kind of, you know, give birth to them. They stride right out of our imagination into the real world. Highly controversial. Certainly one of the other most fascinating for me, but equally controversial aspects and certainly strange aspects of the mystery, is that particularly in England and America, when the MIB are seen driving these old-fashioned cars, that there are a number of reports on record where the cars just seem to literally, and I do mean literally, dematerialize, as if, you know, they've just vanished into nothingness. Now, again, that sounds highly bizarre, but everything about the Men in Black is bizarre. But we get reports, you know, little-known cases from England that really have, you know, only been told from one friend to another, and then somebody's leaked it out eventually to the UFO community, paralleling very closely similar stories to the United States. You know, I mean, that again takes the MIB stories down a very strange path, You know, they're not only driving old-fashioned cars, these cars seem to have like a limited lifespan. You know, one minute here, they're here, and the next minute, they're literally gone.
Well, that's a good point. Let's take some calls here, Nick. Okay. Tim in Phoenix, Arizona. Probably brutally hot there, Tim. Go ahead.
Oh, yeah. Today, 111, we're officially in the hell zone.
Oh.
Forgive my voice, I have a little congestion here tonight. Some time ago, but this was back in the late 70s when I was still in high school, my cousins and I, we'd frequently go out for coffee after church or whatever and talk about UFOs. And there was one night when we were sitting in the booth, and I was looking out the window to the street as I was telling somebody, the group there, about the Betty and Barney Hill case.
Mm-hmm.
And just as I got to the point where I was describing the aliens, this fairly tall figure, very skinny, walking very stiffly in a black suit and a long, skinny black tie, walks right down the... Okay, I'm so scared. I got goosebumps just thinking about it now. And it was walking right in front of me as I'm looking out the window, and everyone looked at me, and I'm aghast. It's like the wind was knocked out of me. They looked. They totally freaked out. And what this creature, what this being had on, it was a person, okay? It was, I think it was a prank, but it was a weird coincidence. Or it could have been another manifestation of the way that the black, the men of black work. There's, somebody had put on a spinal foam head, you know, that holds a wig, put on a nylon stocking over that, and put on a very long suit to put it over their head so that they look like a real long, real tall alien, you know, in a black suit. And this is before the Men in Black phenomenon took off in the movies and so forth. But we couldn't believe it. It's just a weird coincidence of that. And I just wanted to throw that one out as another possible way that they, what people stop talking about these
things. Well, that's interesting. Halloween's coming a little early. Tim, hey, thanks. Yeah, Phoenix getting blasted away. You know what? What kind of a person, though, would be dumb enough to run around in a Bigfoot costume or dressed up like a Men in Black, you know? I wouldn't.
Well, no, I mean, you know, certainly Bigfoot, you might get yourself shot in the woods, you know, that may well happen one day, you know. But, you know, the Men in Black, again, it's, you know, we have these questions. I mean, it's an intriguing story, you know, we do get cases like this, some of which we can resolve, you know, in down-to-earth terms. Others just still elude us, you know, 40, 50 years onwards.
Next up, we go to Marty in Charleston, West Virginia, east of the Rockies. Hey, Marty, thanks for calling. Go ahead.
Hi.
Hi.
Well, are you there?
Yes.
Okay, I got cut off last time. I got to meet Frank Edwards, who wrote Stranger Than Science and UFO Serious Business.
Cool. Yeah. He was a classic giant in his day.
He was, and my dad had a bookstore. So I got to listen in on all the conversations that day when he was signing autographs. And he told my dad, after we closed the store, about a female reporter in her 20s that had warned him that she was being followed by these strange men in black, and that he was going to investigate the Braxton County Monster incident, which is in West Virginia, and she told him not to because strange things were starting to happen. Well, then it turned out not too long after that, after she warned him, she died suddenly of a heart attack, and she was in her 20s. Which
is
kind of strange.
No, that is. I mean, you do actually get a number of stories like that where, you know, people have done research into people in the UFO community who've died under questionable circumstances.
Absolutely.
And, you know, there's sort of a growing body of reports. Now, I mean, you know, to what extent we're able to actually, you know, demonstrate a direct connection with the MIB, you know, that's open to debate, but, you know, there have been a number of cases where I think, like, for example, Morris Jessup, who was one of the big players on the UFO subject in the 50s, his death is still seen by many researchers as highly suspicious. So, you know, I think, you know, although it's sort of an ominous, disturbing area, I think, you know, this is actually a subject that we really should be digging more into. You know, the idea that the threat level goes from not just intimidation, but, you know, if you get really close, you know, is the ultimate step taken to sort of, you know, prevent you getting any further, you know, and I wouldn't rule it out.
All right, let's go to Christopher in Los Angeles. He's up with us, first-time caller. Christopher, hi.
Hi, guys. How you doing? Thank you for taking my call. I appreciate it. I wanted to talk to you guys about an experience that I had back in 2005, and I heard that, George, you're familiar with Southern Illinois University at Edwardsville, and one night, after studying with my friend Jason, he and I was dropping back home at Cougar Village, which is an apartment complex for students that's dorms, basically. And it's in a really thick wooded area. And it was about 3:30 in the morning. It was pretty late. And I dropped him off. I'm driving back. And all of a sudden, out of my left-hand view, I saw this really bright object. And I didn't know what it was. It was really bright, like a star. Sorry, I'm kind of nervous because it was a really intense experience. And this object was glowing. I was on North University Drive, made a left, and this object came up from above the tree line, started following me, and followed me for maybe about half a mile to a mile on North University Drive where it meets Old Pogue. And I'm sitting there smacking myself in the face 3 times. I was like, thought I was hallucinating or something. It's clearly real. And I came to a four-way stop, and this object went from probably what was 45, 50 miles an hour to, I mean, honestly, 10,000. It just left the atmosphere in a split second. Raced home, called my friend that I just dropped off, called my girlfriend at the time, and, you know, no one believed me. So I filed a report on, I can't remember what website it was. It was like a UFO.
Probably the National UFO Reporting Center.
That I tried to find the most official one that I could find. Filed a report. A day later, I get a visit at my front door from a man dressed in black with a hat, really weird looking eyes. And he asked me a bunch of questions, you know, my name, family history, if there was any, like, case of psychosis, if I was crazy, basically.
Did he identify himself, Christopher?
He didn't give his name. He just said that, I can't remember what agency that he said he was from. My phone's going to die. I better hurry up.
He made it sound official, though, didn't he? All right. Well, we're getting out of range here with you. Have you ever been threatened, Nick, at all in your work by any of these?
No, people often ask me that, you know, having sort of written the book. I haven't. The closest I've sort of ever come to anything like this is that occasionally, you know, I've interviewed people where, you know, they might have emailed me and said, you know, I've got a story to tell you. And I'll be like, well, you know, yeah, great. I'm going to be away for a couple of days. Can I give you a call in, say, 3 or 4 days when I get back? You know, we can chat about it. And then when I call them, you know, the whole tone's changed. They're quite reticent and reluctant. So this has happened perhaps on, you know, a dozen occasions over the course of 15 years or so, where it's clear that the person's opened up and said, well, you know, after we first spoke, that, you know, I had this weird phone call where somebody suggested it would be a good idea not to talk with you about this experience. And he actually put people off speaking. And so, you know, in other words, I've not been intimidated or anything like that. You know, I've not had that sort of visitation. But people I've been planning to interview, it's almost like somebody's intervened to dissuade them from speaking, which, of course, you know, sort of begs all sorts of questions about telephone monitoring programs and all sorts of things along those lines, you know, when you know, secret surveillance of people in the UFO community, etc.
I never thought of them as being demonic, but since you've brought it up, Nick, it might make sense as a strong possibility, doesn't it?
Well, yeah, I mean, to me, the demonic angle is an interesting one, but I think, you know, it depends how you define what, you know, demons are, you know, or aren't. You know, are we talking about something that's literally demonic, or are we talking about an entity that we don't fully understand that resides in some other realm or, you know, quasi-dimension, and we give it like a demonic terminology as a means to understand what it may be. You know, I think, but there's absolutely no doubt that when you look into this mystery, you know, you do find these sort of occult overtones with poltergeist activity and people using Ouija boards who've been visited, and, you know, it does take you down some very dark and winding and ominous pathways, you know, that you don't initially think you're going to go down. You think it's going to be just government people flashing ID cards and saying, hey, you know, just cut that UFO research out. It goes far, far beyond that.
All right, let's go to Astatula, Florida, and it's Thomas on Coast to Coast. Hi, Thomas.
Yes, sir. One of the things that causes me, why in black? Why not in white? As in demonic in black, angelic in white? Different entities are the source and the reason why they tend to conceal themselves as they do. And also in the movies, so they say, is that they wipe your mind clear of any experience you may have had. And the little bit that we know that we're babbling about this evening is cause concern of what really happens when we're not around. Do we remember? Is that the purpose of them even contacting it? You follow kind of what I'm saying? I'm very intrigued about it. Demonic, angelic, white, black, what's right, what's right.
All right, you might have a point there, Nick.
Yeah, I mean, you know, this is an interesting angle, you know, the sort of the archetypal sort of shadowy dark figure, you know, is something that extends throughout history. It's not just a modern day thing, and, you know, sort of a black intimidating suit, the hat, the sunglasses, you know, by default, it is all intimidating. And, you know, you make a valid point where you talk about sort of the angelic white good angle and then the sort of the ominous man in black who's, you know, defined as being definitively evil. I mean, to give you an example, you can go back sort of the 1500s, 1600s, when you had certain alchemists, you know, trying to turn base metal into precious metals. You can find a number of old stories of alchemists from that period who said, you know, they would get a visit late at night from this strange, ominous, black-dressed figure who would warn them about the hazards of, you know, digging into alternative science like alchemy, you know, and they would appear and then just again vanish into the night. And there was this sort of air of, you know, like an evil presence about them. And, you know, you do have to wonder, are we looking at sort of, you know, left and right hand, like a good and evil type phenomena? You know, I can't rule it out.
Well, all right, stick with us. We're going to come back, Nick, in just a moment on Coast to Coast AM. We're going to take final phone calls here. We'll go to San Bernardino, Yellow Springs in Ohio, Atlanta, Georgia, the state of Washington, and much more as we talk with Nick Redfern